Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I'm your host, Norman, Norman Oliver. Well, I've been getting so many phone calls, so many emails, so many texts about interviews that we've been doing. The John Carlos interviews, the Sonny Vaccaro interview, the interview with the nurse talking about COVID and also talking about breast cancer, especially as it relates to women of black and brown color. The basketball interview, we've gotten so, Geno Jennings, we got like over a million viewers. So this is how this whole TV, this whole DETV with Ivan and his whole crew is doing. I mean, these guys are doing a phenomenal job. So today, I'm gonna bring you a person that's close and dear to me. It's a phenomenal story, that I had no idea that it would take place. Let me set the stage. Maybe you've had a father or uncle or brother who served in the Vietnam War or Korean War. A lot of times something happened in those wars when these guys went over there and served. They met young women and they had affairs with these young ladies. And a lot of times these guys impregnated and had women, had babies and left them and came back to the United States. Unbeknownst to me and my family, we had a brother. My sister, Sheila, and Marilyn's daughter is on the internet, and she goes to this heritage.com or something. My brother tell you about this, and come to find out these guys have a match. I have no idea how this stuff works. I get a phone call, and I have a brother who looks just like us. And he had written a book. I got this book. He sent me this book, One Hand, One Hat. And he talks about my father and his search. And you can only imagine how emotional it was to find out that you have an older brother in his 60s who've been trying to find us. So he and I we've really become close over the last year or so. Maybe some tears, maybe some joy, maybe a little bit of everything. But I wanted to introduce my audience to my oldest brother, because he's my older brother. And maybe someone who's watching has some of the same story or same scenario and you didn't even know. How you doing, Robert? And Robert's over in the UK, by the way.
Norman, hi. Again, thank you very much for inviting me onto your show. I'm good, thank you. And I had a bit of a tearful moment then. Mm-hmm. A little tearful moment.
Well, that's okay, because so have I. Hey, Robert, tell a story. We're going to tell you a whole story. But if you could tell a little bit about my father, your mother, situation, how we came here. Because it's really fascinating.
Well, again, as you mentioned, Norman, I found out only in April that I've got eight brothers and sisters in the US. You know, yourselves and the Browns. Just very, very quickly, I was brought up in West London in the 50s, and I was the only kid in my class that didn't have a father, which was obviously, it's quite hard to imagine now. And my mum always said that my father was a black American serviceman and his name was Robert Brown. She had letters from Robert and she had a couple of photos, but I was always really in the dark as to about my father, because she didn't really speak about it a great deal. And it was a stigma in those days, Norman, in the 50s, being brought up illegitimate. So it was quite tough for me, really. But I've come a long way. I'm 65 years of age. Mm-hmm. And you know, finding that you guys through Aaron Stull was, I don't want to be too biblical, but it was a miracle, really.
You can be biblical. So I read in your book where you sent my father, our father, letters, and you never got a return call, never got a return letter or anything, because they were on visit.
That's right, yeah. Norman, I think we've mentioned this, we've touched on it before. I probably put it to the back of my mind that I didn't have a father, so I accepted it. But I think it must have been around 1998, 99, where my mother, she'd been interviewed from somebody who's writing a book about GI soldiers that had gone to Vietnam or Korea or wherever, and not just Americans, you know, the British mm-hmm. have done it exactly the same. Right. And anyway, she was mentioning about her son in a book. And the author of this book, which I can't remember what it was, but they were saying that you can find out your father's heritage, his details, if you had a military number. And my mum always kept, my father's, I think it was Robert had written his number, his military number, on an envelope. So we always had this. Now, I've been in the army, Norman, as you know, 15 years. Mm-hmm. And it's a little bit like a national insurance number or a driving license. Right. You can always find somebody through this number. So I wrote to, I think it was your State Department. And I had, obviously, Robert's number. And they wrote back to me and they said, yeah, this man, Robert Brown, and he was living in Wilmington. Mm. This was about 97, 98, something like this. So the address I had, I wrote to him. Now, I gave him, Norman, I gave him a get out. Do you know what I mean? I said, look, I mean, at the time I was a police officer, a serving police officer. I was on the Royal and Diplomatic Protection Group at the time. Mm-hmm. I was working at Eton College. I was guarding Prince William and Prince Harry. So I thought I was quite a prestige guy. However, I did say, look, I don't know your circumstances. And if I don't hear from you, I fully understand. So again, say 98. So the address that they gave me was in Wilmington. That's all I remember. Mm-hmm. And I didn't hear back from him. Now, I was a little bit disappointed, but I could understand because I didn't know his circumstances. You know, he's receiving a letter from a person who he had not really heard of for 50 odd years. So, but again, we've spoken about this, haven't we? Maybe he didn't get the letter, Norm. I don't know. But I was a little saddened to be truthful.
So folks who just tuned in to Community Crossfire, Another Point of View, I found out like 8 months ago, 9 months ago, I have a brother in the UK. And so I'm interviewing him now. We were going to meet in Miami until COVID came out. So I wanted him to come to you and tell this story, and maybe it'll help someone else. He and I have already embraced, and I've had my little tears. I'm sorry, sure he's had his. So Robert, now we get to the point where you find out, you meet me and Robert and Cisco and Xanthia and our brothers, you know, Sheila and Robert. What goes through your mind when you like, wow, I think that this is real, like this DNA is real? I have a friend, Cy Wolford, who does this kind of stuff. Because when I got the phone call from my brother, I was like, and I always suspected it, right? For some reason, I suspected I had a brother. I thought it was Mexico, because me and my father would talk about that. And so now I have a brother. What was the first thing went through your mind when you're like, wow, I found him? Then you found out he's passed away.
Well, I was, it was very lucky how it worked out, Norman, because, I did the test, and as people know, that you come back with all this information and it tells you about your ethnicity. And mine was quite interesting. And that was my main aim of this DNA test. I wasn't really, in my mind, I wasn't even thinking about relatives. And with the company that I went to, after they gave me the initial test of my authenticity, then they started bombarding me with further emails about buying more programs to, they would do my family tree and such like, you know, and they, you know, it was getting a little bit tedious, and I nearly put their responses in my email, my junk box. And I can remember, because there's a sidebar and it says about you've got 1% DNA or 5%. And I got one and I nearly deleted it. I just saw it said, I mean, I'm going to say her name. It was Erin Saul, and it was 13%, 13% possible niece. And I thought, wow, that's, you know, in the USA. Now, you can put your photograph on your profile if you want, or you can have it a blank screen. And Erin decided to have a blank screen, so I couldn't see what she looked like. So I just, you can email through the DNA site, you email the recipient. And I was a little bit skeptical. I thought, is this a bit of a scam? So I didn't hear anything, Norman, for about over a week, and I'd forgotten about it. And I was in the attic, and my phone pinged, I've got an email. And it was from Erin Saul, and it said something like, did your father serve in the forces, and was his name Robert Brown? Because that was my grandfather. Now you can imagine, wow. That was no one's ever said or mentioned Robert Brown other than my mother. Mm. And then, I was shocked. I really was shocked, Norm. I'm still shocked now, you know, thinking about it. You know, you can imagine. And I came downstairs and spoke to my wife about it. And so I'm quickly emailing this woman back, still thinking, you know, is this a con? And she contacted me back and saying, you know, you've got a sister, her mother, Sheila, and then Robert Brown, and then you've got another family, the Olivers. Mm. And wow. But it was funny that, you know, you mentioned you wasn't really quite sure about me. But when I speak to Sheila was saying that when Sonny got a little bit morose, upset, he mentioned me.
Mm.
And they had an idea that they had a brother in the London area and his name was Robert. That's all they knew. Mm. And that was quite sort of emotional for me, really. You know, that my father actually, although, you know, when he was a little bit down, but he recognized me. And that meant a lot to me.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you just tuned in, this is my brother Robert from London, who we just found out that we were brothers 11 months. And you guys know Robert Oliver, and I don't know if you know other Robert Brown. This is Robert Brewer. So I think my father had a thing about Roberts. So, but it's really fascinating. And I hope that this story, Robert, and the reason why I asked you to come on, that it would help someone else, and someone else would, I mean, this is the kind of stuff you see in Oprah Winfrey or Maury Povich or... Yeah. When it was, now it hits us reality. I mean, you see this on TV where people are like, I found my brother. You know what I mean? And you and I have had, and you and I, wow, we've grown really close. We talk a lot. We send emails. We text. And I don't want to dwell on that story a lot, but I had to just to let people know the contents, you know, the context of this right here, because maybe it will inspire someone. And I had to get the courage up to call you and do it. You know, I've been wanting to interview you. And it just really hit me. And you and I talked this morning here in afternoon your time. This is a 6-hour difference. And I was honored that you had the courage and would do it. So let's switch a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about your life, because I got like another 20 minutes. So you served in the war. You served as a police officer. You act as an actor. You got little minor roles in, I guess, like as a stuntman. I don't know what you would call it. So, and you've been married a few times, and you have a few kids. Tell me about your life now, or tell my viewing audience about my oldest brother's life. So I know my brother Robert's probably a little pissed, and Ryan, that you're the oldest brother now, but they get over it. Go ahead.
Well, I start at the beginning, born in West London, and went to the local primary school. The only coloured kid in the school, because that's what we were referred to in those days in the 50s, coloured. And it was tough for me because I think I mentioned in the book that I was stigmatised. But I'm not going to blame the school system because I was at fault as well. It's in the book, yeah.
Yeah. I'm showing people if they want to buy it. Go ahead.
So it was, I think I mentioned it. The school failed me and I failed the school. So it was even Stevens. But I never managed to do a whole playtime, lunch break, dinner break, without being told to go to the naughty wall. And looking back, Norman, we all respond differently to discipline, don't we?
Right.
And with me, being confrontation, it never worked with me because I was a stubborn person. Later on in my school career, if I misbehaved, we were caned or slippered. So it was physical, physical. And after a little while, I wasn't a tough guy, but it didn't really affect me. What was best for me was someone sitting down and explaining it. And that's what I do to my children now. I mean, I've got my two girls, 30 and 20, 25. The eldest one, certainly, she is very similar to me. And when she had a bad report, I used to sit down and tell her and speak to her and listen and say, you've let us all down.
Let me ask you something before you go on any further. Had you ever told them the story before you met us? Did you ever tell them that you thought you had brothers or sisters or a father in USA? Or the conversation never came up?
Norman, I had no idea I had any brothers or sisters in the US.
But what about the father? Did you ever say, I just never met?
Yes. Oh, yeah. They were aware that my father was an ex-serviceman in the US Army. But other than that, very, very little. And he never came up in the conversation, wow. Really.
Because our father, you and our father, met your mother in a London or a Paris club.
London club, yeah. Wow. I think it was the Empire in what's called West London. Wow. And that was where, so this had been in 53, 54, 55, because I think Robert was over there during the Korean War, our father. He was there serving, maybe. And
this is crazy. We're having this conversation, ladies and gentlemen, but Ivan, do you understand how crazy this is? This is like a storybook. You know what I mean? I just want to hug you, man. I just want to tell you I love you. You know what I mean? Golly days. So you protected the princes and queens and...
Yeah.
I know. How does that work?
The queen mum. Not the queen. So it was initially, it was what's called, you were called the protection group. That was the Royal and Diplomatic Protection Group. It sounds posh, but it's not really. But there you go. So we were, the bodyguards... You've heard of the bodyguard? We were the bodyguard to the bodyguard to the bodyguard. We were, we helped. And so initially I protected the Queen Mum and Prince Andrew. Prince Andrew, who's going through a bit of a Tory time at the moment. Mm-hmm. So this was in 96. And then in 98, when Prince William went to Eton College, I protected him. And there was others as well, it just wasn't me. And Harry the following year. Oh, so wow. In total, yeah. So they were together for the first couple of years. William was on his own. And then a few years they were together, and then William left, and Harry was on his own. So they overlapped. But I was probably about 2 years, and I used to take William on military training, army training. Yeah.
I have a pretty cool, famous brother, man. Maybe
nah.
if I come visit you, I can get some perks,
Probably not.
I never had any problem with asking for perks, man. And not Percocets, perk like food and drinks and clubs.
Norman, tell me about that baseball cap that you're wearing. What's that?
So my brother sent me this baseball cap over, right? I mean, look how cool it is. Got my name on the back and... I mean, it looked like the party for Gail and all that kind of guys. So you tell me what exactly is it, because you sent it to me.
That's right, I did. Yeah, I sent the baseball cap to Norman and all the brothers and sisters and Robert Brown and Sheila Brown. And it's a regimental hat. Regiment, like the 7th Cavalry. 7th Cavalry, that's the Well, my regiment, the Queen's Regiment, because that's when I joined. I joined the Queen's Regiment, because you'll see underneath this is the Queen's. And it's a lot of history. There's a lot of history there. There's the dragon, in Latin, honi sauci mali pants, which is evil to those who do evil and such like. And that was the regiment I joined when I was 15 and a half.
Wow.
15 and a half, yeah. And that made me, Norman. You know, I was going on the wrong track.
I was going to say this. So you was kind of rebellious when you were younger, right?
Yeah, I was, because I didn't know any, I had no male role model. I had no sisters to guide me.
It was just you and your mother.
Just my mother. And my mother, she had a tough life. You know, she had a very hard life. She was on her own for a lot of years, and she just looked after my grandfather for a lot of her life, really. So she didn't really have a life to speak of.
Hey, Robert, can I go back for 1 second?
Yeah.
I want to cover things with you. So there was a time that people whose father, whatever, wherever part of the world they were from, right? Especially in the United States, you couldn't find that until Bill Clinton came in office. You were telling me something about that law. What was that?
Sorry, say that again. Normally,
I think that you said something about Bill Clinton. Was it Bill Clinton's administration that opened it up where people were able to finally look for, or was it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it was the Clinton administration, and they allowed illegitimate children from the American GIs to trace their fathers. I'm not quite sure if it was a good thing or not, but yeah, that was.
I think it's a great thing. I mean, can you imagine? Yeah. I mean, look with us. I mean, what are you trying to say here? You know, you didn't want to meet me.
Yeah, I love it. But you know, are you pushing Bill Clinton? But no, it was. I mean, we mentioned about Bill Clinton before, and from our point. Our perspective, we don't understand American politics, but to a lot of the British people, Clinton did come across as quite a good man. We don't know how accurate that was, but he did seem quite a good president, if you could call him a good president. I don't know, but
let me ask you, so all the way up until then, you couldn't look for the person?
No.
There was a law actually in place that said, guess when Nixon and all these guys were in office, Johnson, you could not look for your father?
You couldn't, they wouldn't help you, basically. You had, you could, if you had a lot of money and you hired, say, a private investigator, then maybe, yeah. But the Clinton administration opened it up. And it just wasn't for Brits, it was a lot for the Vietnamese. Kids.
I can only imagine. I mean, I had an opportunity to go over to Vietnam, Singapore, and Hong Kong. A lot of them, I'm like, are you sure you're not my sister, brother? God, man, this is pretty cool. So what else you got going on in your life? Are you retired now? What you got going on?
The official title, Norman, is supporting artist. That sounds a bit flash, doesn't it? But I'm an extra, TV and film extra. I can't tell you what I'm on at the moment. So I'm doing something at the moment. They're very strict production. But it's just come out now. And the Wonder Woman 2. Right. So I'm in that.
Oh, cool.
And we've got that. We've streamed that. And so we're going to watch it tonight. Wonder Woman 2, Bond.
So do I have to look really hard, like, there's that guy.
Yeah. You're never going to find me. No, yeah.
What's the weather like over there now? What's the weather?
Bad.
Cold?
Cold. Typical English, foggy, misty weather. Yeah. That is why Brits, millions of us, we'll go to Florida now. We go to Spain or whatever, but obviously, with COVID, that's stopped a lot of people.
How are you guys doing with COVID over there? I think I was reading something like, if you want to come over here, you got to get tested like 72 hours before. Now, did you see that?
I don't think we can come over at the moment. Only if it's, you can't, you, I don't think you can visit the States for holiday, Norm. It's only if it's business.
Are you guys quarantined right now? Or, I mean, it's really spiked over there, right?
Yeah. Yeah, the numbers are, it's very difficult here. We're going through a bit of a bad time at the moment, unfortunately.
Yeah. Do you guys have the vaccine too? Do you have the needle?
No. We're getting it, yeah, but although I'm old, I'm not that old.
Will you be able to get it?
Yeah.
Would you take it?
Oh, yes, yeah. Why wouldn't you?
I mean, yeah, I would, but a lot of people are apprehensive. I don't know why. I mean, I would take it.
Yeah.
So are you guys, because every place is different. And after this interview, I'm interviewing my friend Terence, who's over in Europe also. So, but you could come outside and go to the stores and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
But on a limited basis, are the bars and stuff closed?
Yeah, they're all closed. But it's
how do you get a good beer? Because you guys like your beer over there.
We do. But the problem is, how can I put it? What state is next to Delaware? Is it Virginia?
You got Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I mean, you got Pennsylvania, you got Washington D.C., you got New York.
Okay, so can you imagine in Philadelphia the bars are closed, but then you go to across the river to Delaware, say, and they're open. Right. And this is what we're encountering here. So, and it's a little bit confusing, basically, and so some people are flouting the rules, which is causing. Our numbers are going quite high, but it's the rest of the world, Norman, isn't it? I mean, I don't know how we're going to get over this, to be honest.
Wow.
I really don't.
So, what do you guys think about our electoral over there? What do you think about like President Trump or President-elect Biden? You can talk politics because can't nobody get to you,
Norman, come on, that's a low ball of that, isn't it?
I don't know. I'm asking. I mean, people who are watching want to know. Do they like our president?
We're a bit baffled.
Okay.
Because we're still not even quite sure. Is Joe Biden actually won?
Yeah.
Has he won? Is it official?
Well, it's official, but not official because the guy won't leave.
Right. It's what we're trying to work it out because I stayed up to watch it, Norm. We're 5 hours in front of you.
Yeah, right. Guys.
And so I stayed up because for the last one. It was Hillary and Donald Trump. I stayed up to watch it in 2016. I found it quite fascinating. You know, when they go, Pennsylvania has gone.
Yeah, right.
Wisconsin and
right.
So I did it again this time, and we couldn't believe it. They're still counting a week later.
If it's up to that guy, they'd be counting 2 years later. Trust me.
But without offending anybody, and I don't know enough about it, but I think most of us, and I'll come off the fence, and I do think that most of my fellow Brits. Are quite pleased that Joe Biden, he's going to be president. We think, but again, we're hearing different conflicts about Donald Trump's taking somebody to court or something, and there's a judicial review going on somewhere. Yeah. But as I said, who knows? But I think most of the world is pretty pleased. But again, America's a big country, and you've got a lot of people with different opinions. And we just can't.
You got a lot of opinions.
We just can't see. We look at Donald Trump as a game show host. We do. I'm sorry. Because I'm coming over to America. I'm due to come over in 8 days.
As soon as you get off the plane, those mega people
are going to be there. They're going to get me, aren't they?
Course. Yeah, watch yourself.
He's a game show host. And,
watch the show, by the way.
Oh dear. Well, but I do like him though.
So when you come over, go like this.
I do. But here's the thing. They say Donald Trump, they like him because he speaks his mind. Well, over here we go pubs. Pubs are full of old men that speak their mind. We just go, okay, old fella, you know, have a good evening. And we just, you know, we leave
let me,
it.
But let me ask you a quick question. Your guy, I forget his name.
Boris?
Boris, right? He had COVID. Boris. He's a big Trump fan though, right?
No, he's not.
I'm not sure. No. I thought they tried to emulate him a little bit.
No, Boris is his own man. You know, Boris. Who knows? Because Trump keeps he kept this dangling this hook. We can do a trade. So you know, everybody bows to the person, don't they? Pretends to be nice, but I think, I don't think he was. I don't think he was, Norm.
Hey, man, thank you so very much for sharing your story. Thank you for coming on my show. And ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed this interview as much as I did. This is my brother, Rob, from London, UK. What an incredible story. What an incredible... People will watch. You have no idea the mixed emotions or the emotions that we went through and probably still go through a little bit. I mean, if you watch when Robert first came on the show, he got a little emotional. And if he gets emotional, I get emotional. And he and I have really become very close. I mean, he's my brother. But I hope this inspiring story, this inspiring interview helps someone else out, you know? Because I had some guys on my show during Father's Day, Robert, who... father was right around the corner. They didn't know him. So you in a whole nother country. So imagine going down the street and your dad walked by you and you didn't know it was your dad. So thank you so much, man. I love you. I appreciate you. And anything in closing you want to say?
Norman, you take it easy and we'll see you in 2021. You take care.
And we'll have a beer. I'll get a light beer because I like my good wine, brother.
Take care. Love the family.
I will tell everybody. Thank you for that inspiring interview. We're out of here.
Hey! Got to pay back. Revenge.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I'm your host, Stormy Norman Oliver. Wow, what an incredible lineup we've had lately. Sonny Vaccaro, we've had John Carlos, my brother over in the UK. We've had doctors, nurses, lawyers, basketball, celebrities. What an incredible show. And I'm getting calls on Pastor Gino Jennings, where we got like over a million hits. We watch Community Crossfire is on fire. And how could it not be on fire until I introduce and talk to my main man, my good brother, my brother, Terence Stansbury, all the way from Europe. How you doing, my brother?
Feeling great, man. Good to be here. Thanks for the invite. Happy holidays, everyone. You know it's always good to chat with you, see you, and it's definitely a pleasure to be on your show here, man.
Hey, Terence, where are you at now?
On the road now, man, France, you know, the lockdown is everywhere. So, you know, I'm moving, not doing too much work, but I'm just going to different places for the holidays.
What countries have you been going to? What countries, I mean, have you been on over there? Before we go there, right, let's take this journey back, right? Terrence and I go all the way back to Bancroft in Newark High. And he went to California, came back, and he was like, Terrence, let's tell an audience who know you, let's tell them a little bit about your journey from Bancroft to Temple University to the NBA.
Well, the best way I can describe it is from the words of my high school coach in LA, the first coach who ever let me play on a high school team. Because as you know, we went to Bancroft together and I didn't even make the team, couldn't play. So the first time I ever made a team was when I moved to Los Angeles and met a coach there. And I ended up playing in Los Angeles 14. And he said, describing my journey was from the asphalt to the NBA. And it's basically how it was. I was a playground ball player in Wilmington, Delaware as a young kid. Couldn't make a school team till I went to LA. And when I came back from LA, everyone saw me. I had grown like 7 inches in a year and a half.
Right.
And had incredible ups and was almost a complete ball player. a transitional ball player because I could play the wing with my size, and I was quick like a smaller guy when I left because I was smaller. And I was a wing, a guard actually, when I was young, when I was before I left. But I had just grown so quickly. And everyone in Delaware thought I was going to play inside until they saw how I played.
Yeah, right.
They saw my size.
So now you're back here in Delaware after being in LA. So you go to Newark High School. Describe what happens at Newark.
Well, basically when I arrived, it was desegregation, as you know. It was a tumultuous period for us, especially us inner city kids being shipped out to the suburbs. A new experience for us. It actually worked out well, I think, for the people in our generation, because we got to see things that we didn't see. We were exposed mainly to the inner city, and schools were segregated in a sense, and right. They had deep segregation. For me, it was great because I had an opportunity to discover new things outside of Wilmington in my neighborhood, to also be around other people from Wilmington who were bussed out there with us, and meet people from Newark. Mm-hmm. I think the best part was being involved in sports because I remember how difficult a period it was when we arrived. They were on strike.
Yeah.
And they didn't want us to come to the schools, the inner city kids going to the suburban schools. And I think sports kind of played a role in us getting together. I think the football season was basically canceled because of that or disrupted.
Yep.
And we started out a few months after the strike was over when they had a school teacher strike. Playing basketball, and Newark's team was full of stars from Wilmington, from the South Side, from the Wilmington High School.
Did Jim Duty know you, or had he heard of you, or because you could have went to Wilmington High, you could have went to Howard, you end up at Newark.
Well, I actually wanted to go to Wilmington High, but they told me I couldn't. I couldn't.
Okay,
I was asked to go to Howard on the East Side because it was a familiar place, but where I was living in Wilmington, I had to go to Newark High. And the only other option, if I wanted to go into stay in Wilmington, would have been Howard High School. But because I was supposed to go to Newark and my friends were going to Newark, I just went to Newark and registered. A couple weeks later, the strike was over. Then a few weeks after that, we had basketball tryouts. I remember the first day meeting Jim Duty. It's a funny story. Because I came home and played at West Center City Community Center, my neighborhood playground court, Hicks Center now, with some friends. And half the people that came to see me at the gym didn't recognize me. They thought I was someone else because of the size, mainly.
Right.
I had to convince them I was still Terry.
Right.
And it was crazy, funny story. But when I enrolled for the basketball team, I remember meeting Jim Duty. He was the coach. And he asked me, fill out a form. You had to have a physical, but come back with the physical. And I got hurt at the community center with my friends like a couple days before the trials started after really playing great. When I was back in Wilmington at the community center. And I gave him my my physical paper. And I said, listen, coach, I can play, but I'm a little hurt. And before I even got the word hurt out, he was like, I'll decide whether you can play or not. That's the first conversation that we ever had. I never forgot it.
So now I'm watching you, right? Because I don't have a little time with you. I'm watching you play down in the parks, and I'm hearing about what you're doing in Philadelphia. So you're giving people work, and this is even before you get to Temple. So how was it playing? Like, did you play in the Sunny Hill, or were you playing in the Baker League, or did you want?
Yeah, well, actually, after Newark, when I had success there, I had received a lot of scholarship offers, and basically I decided to go to Temple. As opposed to going to the West Coast, which was my dream school back in Los Angeles. That's where I always wanted to go as a kid. If I couldn't go to an ACC school or Georgetown, and Temple recruited me. So I made a decision there because of Don Casey, Jim Maloney, and Jay Norman, great coaching staff. But in order to prepare for Temple, and I was going to play the guard because Jim Duty, actually, I was playing a forward the first year at Newark because of my size. And we had so many smaller guys. And then my senior year, we had even more smaller guys. So I really had to play forward. But we were struggling and that year with the team. And John Thompson had came to see me play. And he was, after the game was over, I think I had a great game. Duty was excited. And he said straight to my face with Jim Duty, I don't think he's good enough to play a guard in Division I basketball.
John Thompson said that?
He came to Newark and recruited me and told me that I could not play Division I basketball as a guard.
You never told me that story.
Yeah, I know. In front of Jim Duty. And I was standing there in shock because I played a good game, you know?
Right.
And I really had a good game, so I was excited. And Duty just looked at him and told him, I think you're wrong. I think you're making a mistake. And then he said, well, maybe he can play Division II as a wing player, but he's too skinny.
Now Thompson used to be my guy. I don't know now.
Well, he's still the guy, but everybody makes mistakes. But here's the moral of the story is what Duty did, his insight was amazing because he knew I could do multiple things with a on the basketball court. He said, Terrence, tomorrow you're going to play point guard. Now I want you to shoot 30 shots a game and stop passing the ball. Wow. And I wasn't used to shooting a lot because I was a complete player. I passed the ball.
You were.
I played defense. I rebounded. And I attacked the basket. And I had a decent jump shot. And I could handle the ball.
Let me ask you a question, Terrence. So Don Casey and those guys out there, they recruited you. Did they ever coach you? Because the only thing I remember is John Chaney.
Well, a lot of people forget that I went to John Chaney's camp after the first year when I went to Newark and was MVP up there. So John Chaney knew about me because I came from Delaware and went to his camp that summer after Newark won the summer league and was the MVP at his camp. He recruited me, but he was at Chaney State, which was Division II school at the time. And I was trying to hold out because I knew that people in Delaware didn't know that when I was in LA, I played on an undefeated team. We actually beat Byron Scott's team in the spring league. I played against a bunch of players from Los Angeles who were going to UNLV, Ohio State, San Jose State, Oregon State. And I was being recruited by Pac-10 schools late in my senior year at Newark. And most people didn't know about that. But I had a reputation on the West Coast and nobody knew me on the East Coast. So what happened was at the end of my senior year, when Duty moved me to guard, everything changed because we started to play in the Delaware Traveling All-Stars AAU team.
Okay.
With Teddy Blunt. And we went to New York. We went to Baltimore. Everywhere we went, we played pretty good. And I got MVP in almost every tournament except for a couple. When we beat Philly, Rob Newman got MVP here at Bancroft. But in New York, I was like an MVP, Baltimore MVP, almost everywhere when we won the tournaments, when we won games. So I went to Sunny Hills High School League that spring. In order to play with those guys. And Spoonie, Steve Martin and I, we would take the train from Wilmington and pay the fare to Chester because we didn't have enough money. We would pay half the fare to Chester with our book bags and act like, you know, we were students falling asleep on the train.
Got you.
And we would get off in downtown Philadelphia and walk all the way from downtown to Temple.
Wow. Okay.
And play in those Sunny Hill High School League games.
How did you do in those leagues?
My team actually made it to the finals. I actually lost in the finals. I lost in the finals that year before I went to Temple.
So did you play 2 years at Temple? Three, four?
Four. I played all 4 years at Temple. So Casey recruited me and Jim Maloney. So they were there my freshman and sophomore year. And actually, I always tell people, and some people don't understand this and wouldn't believe it, my freshman team was the best team I ever played on at Temple.
Get out of here.
Yes, Alton McCullough, Neil Robinson, Keith Parham, Mark Davis from Lappahaw, Georgia. Granger Hall was on that team too, but didn't play much. Jim McLaughlin. That was the best team I've ever played with at Temple, even though my senior year we had a better ranked team, you know, a more known team. But my freshman year, we had a great team.
You know, really Don Casey and I talk almost every other day. He always talks about. So he left.
I just gave you a number again. That's how they got in touch with you. Because he asked me for it a few weeks ago.
So Don leaves to go to NBA.
Yeah, what happened was my junior year, he was still under contract, but we had a new president, Peter Lee, of course. He came in and he wanted to change the direction of the university because we had, in those days, only 32 teams went to the NCAA tournament, 32. And we were ranked number 34 my freshman year, maybe like 45 my sophomore year. We lost in our conference championship finals my freshman year. So we got invited to the NITs and we played against Larry Nance and Clemson. And then we end up losing to West Virginia, I think. Then my sophomore year, we got invited to the NITs and we lost to Dominique Wilkins in Georgia, in Athens, Georgia. We was playing the University of Georgia. So my junior year, Casey leaves to go to the Chicago Bulls and John Chaney comes in. And we have a great team that year, but four or five players got hurt. Three starters got hurt, so we kind of struggled. So it was basically Jim McLaughlin, myself, colleague Nish from Wilmington, Delaware, Charlie Rain from Delaware, who was also recruited by Temple. I was there. I took the coaches to Indian River to see Charlie Ring while he was still in high school.
Wow, that's a fascinating story. So now you're in your senior year, right? What happened in your senior year? I remember, only thing I remember is that shot against St. John's with Chris Mullins. But you can tell
Well, my senior year actually was the year that everyone remembers, and people think that's the best team, and it was a great team. The year before, all the players who were hurt came back again, so we had all returning players on our team, and we added Nate Blackwell, the Philadelphia Public League Player of the Year, great player, Day-Day. So we had a strong team, and we actually lived up to our capabilities. Huh? We went undefeated in the Atlantic 10 tournament that year, and we ended up losing in the second round of the NCAA tournament against Michael Jordan, Sam Perkins, Kenny Smith, and four guys who got drafted eventually in the first round in the NBA. But I got player of the year in Atlantic 10 that year, made All-American, was invited to the Olympic trials, and eventually got drafted to the NBA. So the first homegrown Delaware, Wilmington, born and raised.
Hey, I keep trying to tell these guys a story. They come on my TV show and they talk. I said, dude, Terence Stansbury, what are you talking about? He's doing work. So now did you go straight to the Pacers? You got nothing against traded, am I right?
No, what happened was I got traded, but I got drafted number 15 to the Dallas Mavericks. The Indiana Pacers had the 18th pick in the first round that year. And that was the only team that I went to visit. And they told me they wanted me really bad, but they thought because of the rumors of the draft that I would not be around at the 18th pick. The craziest story that you can imagine was my agent told me that I might go 15. And I'm like, 15 in the first round, that's wonderful. He said, no, they don't want you. They're just going to use you to get rid of someone else. And the night before the draft, the Utah Jazz called my house and asked me, if they drafted me, would I come and play for them? Because they had drafted Dominique before and he didn't want to play for the Jazz. So they ended up having to trade him to the Atlanta Hawks. I was like, are you crazy? I'll be the first person born in Delaware, born and raised, drafted in the first round in the NBA. Right. I'm going to go to any team that takes me. So I ended up going to Dallas and I flew out the day after the draft and they never called me back. They didn't talk to me. They were trying to work a deal because they had drafted Billy Garnett a few years before, I think number 3 in the draft. And he turned out not to be the player they expected because they had Mark Aguirre. They had, they had a player from Michigan who played with Magic Johnson at the time. And those guys played his position. So they outplayed the draft choice they had. And we end up playing in preseason because I held out for my agent because we didn't come to an agreement. I ended up going to training camp late, maybe like 2 weeks before the season started. When I got there, the first game I ever played in was against the Indiana Pacers. But the first game I suited up against in was with the Philadelphia 76ers.
Right.
Against Dr. J and Charles Barkley when he was a rookie. But they stopped the game in the first quarter because of condensation on the floor in Fort Worth, Texas.
Wow.
Dr. J fell on the floor in the warm-up line, almost like broke his back. I slipped. I remember going up for a layup because the floor was wet. And then when the game started, Rolando Blackman slipped and fell.
Oh, wow.
So the owner of the Mavericks got up at the time and got on the mic and told everybody, you know, you can get your money back. We canceled the game. We just signed Rolando for a new $11 million, 10-year contract or something like that. We don't want him to get hurt. So they stopped the game for Rolando, but they didn't stop it for Dr. J.
Ladies and gentlemen, listen to these stories. That's why you tune in to Community Crossfire. Terence, we got so much to talk about in so little time. So how was that first All-Star game when you was in a dunk contest? A lot of people want to know about that.
Well, initially, I wasn't selected. Charles Barkley was selected. But a couple of weeks, about a week before the draft, it was in Indianapolis. So they asked me if I wanted to take the place of Charles because he didn't want to do the dunk contest. And I was like, of course, you know, I got plenty of dunks. That's what I'm known for on the West Side. You know, I wasn't known for that at Temple and University because game had changed. But in high school and on the West Side of Wilmington, everybody knew me as a high flyer. So I was like, I have so many dunks, they don't know.
Right.
We're creative on the West Side. I'm a playground guy. And I stole everything from everyone I knew on the West Side in my neighborhood. I stole everything that I liked from every single one of them. So I took Delaware with me everywhere I went. I was excited.
Who were some of the guys that you admired? And you talk about West Side and Delaware. Who were some of the players that you admired?
Well, going close to your side of town, Leon Wilson.
Okay.
I thought he was one of the most complete players to come out of Wilmington when I was watching him, because he could handle the ball. He had great size. He could shoot. He was a scorer. But as guards, you got to talk about Kenny Henson. I thought he was probably the greatest point guard that we had produced at Howard. Guys like Marshall Washington, Nate Evans, Evans brothers. There were so many players that I thought as a young kid, when I couldn't make the teams in Wilmington, that I knew could play.
You know, I used to like when you and Chung King, you guys used to go out in the park.
My contemporaries, you can talk, we're talking about different peoples. Now, my contemporaries, you know, I had guys, whew, the Park Twins, they were, to me, Charlie Smith was, I thought, probably the best two guard that we ever had, pure two, because I wasn't really pure. I was just a player who played different positions. I could play the two,
these guys about this, man. Talk to me, Terrence. I was trying to tell these boys. Go ahead.
My favorite, to go back to my favorite player of my time, it has to be T.C. Ransbury, because we knew each other from an early age. And then we eventually, he was at Wilmington High on their state championship team, like the sixth man. And I think it was 76, 77 season. Yeah. And I was in L.A. And then in 77, 78, we played together at Newark, and he was the player of the year. And then next year, I was player of the year. So I got a chance to play with one of my childhood friends. And I learned a lot playing with TC because he was a smooth player. He was really a smooth player and a cerebral player. You know, he played like he played with his head. So I played against Chung King. I remember in junior high, I watched him in Craig V. Shields. Mm-hmm. The first time that I really tried to play in junior high at Bancroft, the guys who I liked the most were Chung and Craig V. Shields. Mm-hmm. Those were my guys. We were at the same time, but I wasn't good enough to make the team. So I watched those guys play a few games in junior high, and I just played on the playground with my friends and at the YMCA until I got better.
I had a great honor. You know, me and Dave Henderson talk about you a lot, and AJ and all them guys talk about just your heroics overseas when you're over Europe. They like you're the Michael Jordan over Europe, and then you become a coach and you become an icon. When I came over to visit you in Paris, you got your own parking spot. I'm like, man, I gotta pay to park, right?
No, that's free for you in Paris. It's free there at my spot. You know that.
So how did you get over there? And tell us a little bit about your journey and what's going on with you over there as a player and as a coach and as an icon now.
Well, okay, before that, let's talk a little bit about AJ and Tony Washington.
Okay.
Because for me, during the time when I was playing at university and when I came back from LA, there was a player, Tony Washington, who I saw, who was probably in the best position to be the first Delawarean to play in the NBA. He had the size, he had the handles, he had the physical body. He played at top universities. And I thought he was going to be an NBA player.
In South Florida.
He played in South Florida and then West Virginia. West Virginia. We played against him and lost to those guys in the Atlantic 10 championship my junior year. So I thought he was going to make it. AJ, to me, is, most people don't understand how great of a basketball player AJ really is. They don't know. He played in the NBA a few years. He played at a Division II school in the state, was All-American, the best player probably in the history of that university, and got drafted in the NBA. But I got a chance to coach AJ when I was in Europe. And I've never seen, he was better than the guys I played with in the NBA. Mm. Better than most of the guards I played with in the NBA, three quarters of them.
Listen, people player. Here in Delaware, listen. Good, bro. We listen.
Okay, now the story about going to Europe. What happened was after, I think, my third season in Seattle, I kind of got hurt a lot that season and then had a serious injury where I hurt my back and didn't play the second half of the season after the third year in the dunk contest, and played a few weeks in the CBA after I got healthy a little bit and then decided I didn't want to be there. And got calls to come play in Europe. So I ended up making a tough decision. At that time, you had to become an amateur to play in Europe. So I had to give up my professional status and requalify as an amateur to play in Europe, even though we were professionals in Europe. And that meant if I played in Europe and then came back to the NBA, I would never be able to play in Europe again. So I was 26 years old and I made a tough decision. I came to Europe and was fortunate enough to play for a team in the Netherlands, Nashua Den Bosch, which was considered to be the the Boston Celtics of the Netherlands. They had won like 7 out of 9 championships and won my first professional championship on that team. And we won 21 straight games after we started to roll, and it was a great experience. So the next year I had a choice. Do I try to go back to the NBA or do I stay in Europe and just continue my professional career? I made a decision to stay in Europe and played in Belgium, Maccabi Brussels at the time, a European Cup team. And then I had an opportunity to play in France, where you know, in Levallois, and you see what happened there. It was a small club when I went there. Very few people knew him. But Albert Butts from LaSalle was one of the Americans who was on the team, and Willie Glass before I played there. So this, when their season was over, I actually went and had a practice game with Albert Butts. Willie Glass had left to go to play with the Hornets in the NBA. And I played with them, and a couple of weeks later, they had offered me a contract. And I waited for about 3 weeks and decided to sign there. And then when I came back to America, I got offered to play for the Jersey Nets. It was too late. I already signed.
Oh, and wow.
So I decided to stay in Europe instead of going to the NBA.
You've made a living over there now. You've been over there for how many years now? About 20, 30?
Oh, it's 33 years now. Off and on, 33 years. It's been a long time, Storm.
You speak
33 years.
Spanish?
You know that. Bien sûr, France. You know, come on, man. Hey, tu sais, je parle français. Mon ami, tu sais. You were there.
You know, I'm so honored and you know, to be your friend, man. And you and I get a chance to talk all the time. And we got to hook you up with this political thing over there. When I went over there, you were like a king. You introduced me to mayors and governors. So I know how you living over there.
No, you the man. you the man. But what people don't understand that I end up playing in a town, and 60 or 70% of our budget came from the city. And my mayor of the city was actually also a governor. So, you know, politics and basketball in Europe is a big thing, more so probably than in the States. It's mostly owners. But in France at the time, a lot of money came through the cities, and you had to work with the city to build a club. And it was a small club when we started. It became a top club that produced a lot of talented professional young kids. And we even have a couple guys who are in the NBA now that actually came from our club. And of course, Tony Parker was coming to our games when he was a young kid, him and his brothers. So
are you in Paris? Are you in Belgium right now? Where are you at right now?
In between right now.
In between Paris and Belgium?
Yeah.
Well, Terence, thank you so very much, man. We're honored. I mean, thank you for giving us a little bit of your time. I wish we had to have more time to talk, and I got to get you back on the community.
Well, hold up. Let me give a shout out to Aurelio Burton, my guy, because that's my best street ball player ever. And Spoonie, yeah. Stephen, Malcolm Martin. And then one sad note, but prayers to the family of Matt Chittum.
Oh, is that horrible?
I heard Matt Chittum died. He passed horrible. Away a few days ago.
Yeah.
So condolences to him and his family and,
Terence,
and everyone who knew.
Terence, let me tell you a quick story about that, right? We all got some stories. When I was starting the Stormen's Classic, the first person who came over my league gave the credibility was Doc Chittum.
Mm-hmm.
Doc came over.
Yep. Yeah.
And then he brought his younger brother over there, Matt, and I was like, what is this? This guy was like an eighth grade dunking on seniors. I mean, could you imagine? We talk about these guys. I mean, because you and I have history, and we know
yeah.
the names you say. This guy could have been greater than anybody. I mean, he had the height.
He could have been better than all of us.
Yeah,
I mean, he had it. He had it all. He had it all. He had the IQ. He had the size. He had everything. It's a tragedy that his career didn't, what happened to him physically, and people didn't get a chance to see what he could have become.
You know, our good friend Lucky Perry passed away, too.
Yeah, Lucky. Also, I heard about that a few years ago. Yeah, I played with Lucky in high school. Lucky was a decent player, too. Very good.
Yeah, we had some good times in Newark High, man.
Oh, it changed our lives.
That's right.
Storm, it changed our lives. You know, me and you go back more than 40 years. We're talking about 43 years.
Neither one of us hair.
And Dave, you talk about Dave Henderson. Dave and I played together. I coached Dave Henderson in Europe.
Ain't that crazy?
I coached Gene Banks in Europe.
I coached
Michael Brooks from Philly in Europe.
Ain't that crazy? you know, me and Mo Howard always talk all the time. Me, Mo, and Dave Henderson become very close. So we have
Mo
a lot
Howard.
Of
Maryland, ACC, love those people, man. They accept me in Philadelphia. They brought me in when I came from Delaware, this skinny kid, you know, and kind of took over their city.
But look how you passed the torch down, though, man, to the Devin Chambers and Shannon McCann.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, Devin.
I mean, all those guys, it's like a torch passing, right? I mean,
that's it's like each one teach one, you know? I played in New York Chinese Nate Archibald's Each One Teach One tournament when Teddy Blunt and those guys, Roger Dean and those guys, Major Harrison took us up there for that tournament.
Oh boy, you talking. See, I know, we gotta get these young boys on, they understand this.
Well, I think they do. I mean, their stories are out there to being told, but a lot of people don't know what happened 40 years ago. It's normal. It's so long ago.
But see how you were a student of the game? You talked about Henson and Marshall Washington, those guys before you. See, these guys should be saying Terence Stansbury, T.C. Ransburg. You understand my point? I mean, like when you and Raleigh, when you guys played, I just come, you know, when you were in Pricey's Park, y'all was a unit.
That was my best backcourt partner ever in basketball. Aurelio.
Dude, I'm telling you,
bro. Aurelio Bird, gold. That was my best backcourt partner ever.
Everybody's going to see this interview. They're going to be like, Storm, y'all could have sat there and talked forever. But I got to sign off, man. Hey, man, I love you. And after this pandemic is over, you know, I'll be over in Europe to come hang with you. You know what I mean? Love you, man.
For sure. Love you, too, man. Great to be here. Peace to everyone. Happy holidays, Delaware.
Thank you, buddy.
Got to pay back. I'm mad. About to get back.